did a poll with the numpy.py file. So the numpy.py file, as I mentioned above, is actually an adaptation of a much longer PDF. And some of it was actually taken from a book called Python for Data Analysis, which is a wonderful O'Reilly book, which does extensible work in Pandas, Scikit-Learn, NumPy, all in a free, You can probably find it for free, PDF, and also a I own the book. It's a very fantastic book. And a lot of this code was taken from chapter 4 of that book, should you wish to look that up as well. So I'm going to go ahead and get started. So I'm going to go ahead and do my imports on line 9 and 10. For this code base, I'm going to be using NumPy as NP, which is another very common abbreviation of NumPy as NP, or Pandas as PD. And I'm also going to be using, towards the end of the code base, matplotlib to be able to plot some of the numbers that we're going to be creating with NumPy. So we actually might not get to it, time permitting, but I do use it in this code base, so I will import it here. So the number one thing that I want us to take away from NumPy is the structure of numbers. So math, like theoretical mathematics, if you ask a mathematician, and they're somewhat social, they'll tell you that mathematics is a theory of structure. It's a theory of how we organize numbers and categories in our brain and on paper so that we can make sense of things that seemingly have no sense. That's what mathematics is to me and to most mathematicians. So NumPy is notably different than base Python in its structure of numbers. So the most basic organization of numbers in base Python is the list. So here I have a variable called data1. Data1 is a base Python list, and it's just 6, 7.5, 8, 0, and 1, and I can run that, and we've created a list, fairly simple. Now, the base collection of objects in NumPy is not called a list, it's actually called an array. And if you're familiar with other computing languages, perhaps C or Java, you might have heard this term array before, and yeah, they're all pretty much the same thing. They're all a one-dimensional structure of elements. Now, to create an array from a base list, we can pretty, oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to ask. Guys in the back, can you read this? I want to make sure, sorry. Raise your hand if you can't read it. Please let me know. Well, you're not in the class, so I don't really care. Which, left or right? You can't, which side? I'm serious. Which side can't you read?
I said I can.
Oh, you can read it, I'm sorry. I thought you couldn't read it. Sorry, I just want to make sure so no one falls behind in the back. So we can actually create a NumPy array by simply stating R1 is my data name, NP, NumPy, dot array, and then as a parameter, I will pass in data1, which is just an ordinary list. So R1, if you take a look at it over in the console, pretty much looks the same, except now we have this array word next to it. So far, there seems to be really no difference between an array and a list. Fair enough. Now, data 2, I'm using base Python notation again. Data 2 is also a list. However, what is each element of that list? Another list. So data 2, if we look at it, kind of looks like this ugly list of lists, right? Well, the first element is the list, 1, 2, 3, 4. The second element is the list, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, that makes sense. It's kind of ugly to look at, but it makes sense. Now, in NumPy, this is where it gets interesting and numerical. When you turn that list of lists into a NumPy array, what it actually does is it converts it to a different type of object. It's called a two-dimensional array, otherwise known as a matrix. So in NumPy, it recognizes the list of lists, and what it tries to do is create this two-dimensional object that it calls the 2D array. So all of a sudden, we've already implemented some more structure that wasn't really apparent in base Python. So numerical Python is all about structuring numbers in a very organized way. Now, for those of you who are probably already guessing or kind of moving ahead of yourselves, what does this two-dimensional array almost remind you of? CSV, yes?
Data frame.
Data frame. In fact, what we're going to see is a data frame is very, very similar to a two-dimensional array. And in fact, we can go from one to the other. So R2 is a two-dimensional array. In fact, if we do the type, and remember the type object asks Python, what is this? And Python will say, this is blank. So if we do type of R2, it will say numpy.ndarray. ndarray stands for n-dimensional. Why n? Why not 1 or 2? Because 3 and 4 and 5 also exist. You can create structures in n dimensions. As many as you need. I'm sure there's a theoretical upper limit to Python, and I'm not actually sure what that is, but it's very large, and I doubt you'll ever hit it. Why make three-dimensional arrays? Because we live in 3D. Why make four-dimensional arrays? Well, math gets complicated after that. R2, so I can go from a list to an n-dimensional array. A to-list will take an n-dimensional array in NumPy and turn it back into a list of lists. So we could very easily go from base Python to numerical Python and vice versa. So that's a very handy feature that numerical Python gives us. NumPy is that we can go back and forth from base very, very easily. So there are some other functions that allow us to kind of explore the data types. R1, if you remember, is that one-dimensional array. If you look at it, the type of it, the data type, the D type, it will tell you that it's a float. A float is 64 stands for I have a 64-bit operating system. So I have 64 bits holding floats inside of R1. Well, why were they floats? And if you remember, R1 was 6, 7.5, 8, 0, and 1. Notice that the numbers I gave it were both a mix of integers and floats. So what it did was it took all of the integers and turned them into floats. Does it always do that? No. In fact, R2, where I only gave it integers, did no such thing. It saw only integers and said, I have no need to convert from integers to floats, so I will keep everything as an integer. Why do you think NumPy felt the need to convert those integers into floats? Anyone? It's making the assumption that if I have at least one float in there, I will eventually be doing math on my numerical Pythonic structure. Well, if I'm going to be doing math with integers and floats, it might be good now to convert everything into a float so that integer division doesn't come back to, you know, bite us in the butt later. That's the basic answer. And later, when I only gave it integers, it said, well, for all integers, he must be expecting integer division because he's put no floats in here, so I'm just going to keep everything as integers. So be aware, because NumPy will actually change the value of your elements when you bring it in. Question? Yes, this will perform integer division in 2.7. Python 2.7, if you don't have Python 3, it will NumPy will still, 5 divided by 3, will still give you an integer. We have another function called ndim. Ndim will give you the number of dimensions of our structure. So R2, being that two-dimensional matrix, has two dimensions, as it's n. There's two dimensions. And later on, of course, there's actually a very interesting... on how we visualize dimensions past 3, and it'll be a fun class. Dot shape, that's interesting. What does that look like? The dot shape method in pandas, which tells you what? What does dot shape tell you in pandas? Rows and columns. What do you think dot shape tells you in NumPy? Look at that, rows and columns. R2, which was just what happened when I took that list of lists and threw it into NumPy, it automatically took the first list, made it a row, took the second list, made it a row, ran out of lists. So it had two rows and four columns. So the shape is a 2x4 matrix. And again, if you want to remember what that is, it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Most Python modules we'll begin constructing row-wise. Because you could have also argued, why didn't the first element become a column? Which is very, you know, that's art. You can ask, why not? It's just that in Python, whoever wrote it, most things happen to be constructed row-wise. So when I gave it the list of lists, the first element became the first row, the second element became the second row, so on and so forth. Yes, Nick?
Yeah, when I ran the shape method, it gave me 2L,4L, instead of just 2,4.
Are you happen to be an IPython or a normal Python console?
I'm in Spyder.
Is it, does it have the ins and outs, or does it have just characters?
Yeah, it has outs and ins.
Okay, so what's, I believe what's happening is that's called a long. A long is a type of,
you know, Windows, right?
Yes, okay. Windows users, you might see an L next to your numbers. That stands for long. It is another data type like integer and float and long. A long is just a larger integer. The idea was that people working with integers didn't have to work with big integers all the time. Sometimes they only have to work with 1,000 or 2,000 or even 50,000. The problem was when they got to the millions and billions, they got slow. And if you told the computer that you might need a billion, but you're only working with two or three, it cuts down on your computation time because it's expecting a billion, but it's only getting 3 or 17. So the long is actually a way of enhancing the size, the range of the integer. So if you see an L next to your numbers, don't panic. Nothing's wrong with your computer. It's just your machine happens to want to use longs instead of integers. Math will not change. That's what the L stands for. R2.size will give us the total number of elements. Why not just stick with len, right? Len gives us the normal length and number of objects. The problem is R2, being that two-dimensional array, the len of R2 is not 8, because the len is actually the size of the first dimension, or the first axis, or the first element of shape. So if you do the len of an n-dimensional array, you won't get all of the elements, or how many elements there are. You'll actually get the length of the first dimension. So there's a dot size method, or sorry, there's a dot size attribute that will tell you how many elements are in your matrix. There are some special types of arrays, and they give you very easy access to them. What if I want 10 zeros in a row? np.zeros 10. Yes, all this does is actually create 10 zeros very quickly. Why? Because numerical Python was built for many reasons, one of which was statistical modeling. And many times, statistical modeling needs you to start at a baseline, or a bunch of zeros. So people, you know, asked the NumPy creators, and they said, can you give us a way to make a lot of zeros very quickly? And they did. And they called it np.zeros. They also asked for the ability to give it two dimensions. So now we can make a 3x6 matrix full of zeros. They also asked for ones. So you can make np.ones 10 and make a one-dimensional array of 10 ones. This is also possible in base Python, which is why they probably extended it into numerical Python. You can say a one, on the bottom right, I'm typing. You can say a one, and you can actually say times 10, and it will actually give you a list of 10 ones. So that functionality exists in base Python, so they just extended it over into numerical Python. These are actually two very, very important functions, lin space and log space, and they become very important when you're doing trial tests, you know, when you want to run different trials of things. Lin space stands for linear space. Lin space will actually give you, so it takes in three parameters, 0, 1, 5, and what it will do is it will give you an array from 0 to 1 inclusive, so including 0 and 1, and it will take 5 points to get there. So it will start at 0, go to 0.25, 0.5, 0.75, 1. So in 5 elements, 5 including 0 and 1, it will evenly space linearly, evenly space points between 0 and 1. Just to kind of make that a little clearer, I'll clear this console and go up on the top right. If I do lin space of 0 to 100, in only 5 points, it will go 0, 25, 50, 75, 100. If I tell it to go to 0 to 106 points, 0, 20, 40, 60, 80, 100. How about in 7 points? Okay, now it's getting kind of interesting. So it's just getting from zero, from beginning to end, in an even linear space. What I mean by even linear space is the same, if you subtract 16 and 0, you get 16.6. There's the same distance between subsequent points. That's what makes it a linear space. More often, you'll see people going, I need to go from linear space from 0 to 100 in 100 points, and or I'm sorry, in, what am I doing? Or yeah, well, I mean, the idea is they want to go from 0 to 1,000, for example, in 100 points, or they want to do a plot from 0 to a million in 100 points, and it just gives them a nice linear space of that range. That's basically all it's doing. Now, log space is very interesting. Log space is very similar to lin space, but it will actually, instead of going from 0 to 3, it will go from 10 to the 0 to 10 to the 3 in 4 points. That seems very interesting. Why would I want to do that? Because in life, many things are what we call exponential. Many things grow exponentially. What that means is, if you were to plot their growth, it would look kind of something like this. It would kind of shoot up fairly quickly. If you recall Calculus 1, probably they did in Calculus 1, you might have learned PERT. That's right. That's why mnemonics are very helpful if you still learn PERT. PERT, P e to the RT, is an exponential growth formula, which models not only the exponential growth of money, but of life, bacteria, in a growth culture. So many things in life grow exponentially, which is why numerical Python gives us an easy way to kind of give us a range of exponentially growing objects. So you'll notice that there is not the same amount of space between 1 and 10, 10 to 100, 100 to 1,000, but the space in between them is growing exponentially. So it gives us a way to easily model exponential growth. Again, I'm not going to go through all of the NumPy tutorial, just because as we need NumPy, I will refer back to this and use it. And I encourage those of you who are very quantitative in nature to look through all of this. And I've included a good amount of NumPy. But I am only going to touch on what I believe are the most important things for today and the next coming days. Slicing is very similar to what you've seen before. R1, which is the one-dimensional array, can be indexed using zero indexing. There's nothing new there from a list. R2 can also take in a zero index. But instead, if you only give it one index, it will only look at the first row, zero. The zeroth row, which is 1, 2, 3, 4. We can give R2 two indices, which is 0, 3. And the way it looks at 0, 3 is it goes at the 0 is the first element. So if I do 0, 3, that is the 0th row, and the 3th, not 3rd, the 3rd index column. So the 0th row is this one, the first row. And the 3 column is 0, 1, 2, 3. So it's 4. So it goes row column. If you've taken linear algebra in high school or college, it's the same structure of finding an element in a matrix. It's row column. Make the L. That's how I did it. Row column. L. Alternatively, we can kind of give it a list of lists format. So we note in the first one that if there's only one set of square brackets and a comma in between the row and the column, here it's the same syntax. I just give it two sets of square brackets, like it were a list of lists. So that syntax is also valid. This is some funky syntax, and what's happening here is the colon does what it usually does in nature. It gives you a range from something to something else. So what we're actually reading here, and I've written it out in English, it will give me all rows, because to the left of the column is rows, and if I just say colon, I mean all of them. Just give me all of them. But only the zeroth column, because to the right of the comma are columns. So give me all rows of the zeroth column. All rows of the zeroth column is just 1, 5. So that's just the first column. Here, it's all rows, comma, 0, 1. So 0, 1 means 0 through 1. So what, anyone want to take a guess as to what this is going to return? All rows, column 0, 1. We get it. So the 0, 1 is similar to the notation. If you remember the range in base Python, What is the range of 0 to 1? So list. Why just 0? You never include the last one. And this is actually the same. So when I say 0 through 1, it's the 0th column, up to but not including the 1 index. Now, to extend that, I'll go ahead in the console on the right. If I write 0 through 2, that will actually give me the first two columns and all of the rows. So this is just some funkier notation on indexing. And again, I've included a link to the full, like this takes them 3 pages to do, just example after example after example. And I just took 6 of them and put it on this condensed code base. This is just some funkier notation in indexing. And the reason this is important is because Pandas data frames also have the same indexing notation. You can also index a data frame using the same notation as a numerical Python matrix. Yes, sorry.
Yeah, so I was looking at the results from the last two rows that we ran. There is a slight variation. So if our second array, rather than being two columns by two rows, instead was two columns by four rows, and you ran the second line, it would return a 4D array. Right, versus that the first time
that we
ran would still be just a
1-meter array. Oh, okay, yes. So good point. So in the first one, when I only gave it one column, it gives me a one-dimensional array. And I also wrote it in the comments here when you look back. This theoretically is the same thing. It's just 1 and 5. But if you look at the way it's structured a little bit differently, because it gave it a range, 0 through 1, even though the range only included 0, it still returned back to me a two-dimensional array. How do you know it's two-dimensional? Well, A, by the way it's formatted, because it's vertical, and also by use of the double set of square brackets. Note in the first one, it's just a single square bracket, so it's a one-dimensional array. Here, they're vertical, and we have much more square brackets than the two-dimensional array, even though it's still the same exact values, just 1 and 5, it's structured differently. And this is exactly what I mean by structure is very, very important in numerical Python. Even though it's still essentially to us just a list of 1 and 5, to NumPy, a one-dimensional list of array of 1 and 5, and a two-dimensional array or matrix of 1 and 5 can be very different. So just thank you for pointing that out. And I also wrote that in the comments. If you want to look back at it later. I am going to skip a little bit down to line 58, where we create a array of strings, Bob, Joe, Will, and Bob. You might remember this notation. If I do names, the array, equals equals Bob, it won't just say false because one's an array, one's a string. It will do element-wise comparison, just like in Pandas. So it will take every single element, compare it to Bob, and tell me true if it was and false if it wasn't. This is exactly the same notation as we use in the logical filtering that you've been doing in Pandas on the homework and in the labs. This is exactly where Pandas gets it from. When I say Pandas does element-wise column operations and comparisons, it's because it's built on top of NumPy that it can do that. NumPy is where Pandas gets its element-wise operations. So similarly, we can do a logical selection. Names, where names does not equal Bob, will give us Joe and Will, just like you might expect in a data frame. Here we have and or, just like we have in base Python. Names equals equals Bob. Oh, yes?
What is IS4? What's the data type?
String. It's a string. Names equals equals Bob or names equals equals Will. Now, whoa, true, false, true, true, where is that coming from? Well, names equals equals Bob. Names equals equals Bob gives us what array? So, right, true, false, false, true. True, false, false, true. Now, names equals equals Will would give us what? Here, so we have Bob, Joe, Will, Bob. False, false, true, false. False, false, true, false. So when I do names equals equals Bob or names equals equals Will, it will do element-wise logic. So this would come out to be true or false, which is true, False or false, which is false. False or true, which is true. True or false, which is true. And that's where the true, false, true, true comes from. That's element-wise logic. It does element-wise comparisons, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and logic. And again, this is where pandas gets its element-wise operations as well, directly from the NumPy arrays. We can assign based on logical filtering, so the names, such that the names are not Bob, turn them into Joe. So when we look at names, any name that wasn't Bob is now Joe. And we have a unique function that will take in a list and tell us back the unique elements in that array. Some fairly basic things. Okay. That is actually where I'm going to stop for now with NumPy. And feel free to read ahead in later on tonight or tomorrow. I will be referring back to this exact file at later times in the course as we need more functionality from NumPy. But that is all that we're going to require for the time being. Are there any questions on numerical Python? The key things, first, the takeaway, are the structure, the one-dimensional array, the two-dimensional arrays. That structure is very, very important in NumPy. And the reason it's going to be important today is because when we do our machine learning, we're actually going to convert our data frame into a two-dimensional array so that we can use its indexing a little bit easier than we would in a data frame. The zero of all rows, all columns. We'll be using that notation a little bit more today. And then the second thing, apart from structure, is that pandas is built on top of NumPy. So whenever you see dot shape, or whenever you see something like the logical filtering, logical comparisons, or element-wise operations, that all comes from numerical Python, from NumPy. You know, in the UFO dataset, when we created the new column location, which was city plus comma plus state, that's just adding two NumPy arrays together, element-wise string addition. So all of that comes from NumPy. That's why it's very important to understand where it comes from. So that's our introduction to NumPy, numerical Python, and I would like to transition over into introduction to machine learning, unless there are any questions on NumPy. We will come back to this later on in the course. All right, well then what I am going to do is I am going to go straight into the slides with the 05ML KNN. Not start at the bottom, I'm going to start here. All right, machine learning and KNN. So we're going to go over what is machine learning. We're going to go over two very important types of machine learning called supervised and unsupervised learning. We'll do a quick summary of that, and then we'll get into a classification with K nearest neighbors, which will be the first machine learning algorithm that we will do in this class. So what is machine learning? There are many definitions, one of which that I like is a field of study that gives computers the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. That was said by Arthur Samuel in 1959, and it's a definition that I like, but not many. Some other people don't like it, and the reason they don't like it is because it sounds a lot like what? The ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. What does that sound like? AI, right? It sounds like it's artificial intelligence. So what's the difference between artificial intelligence and machine learning? Well, to me and to most people, artificial intelligence is not specifically the ability for machines to learn without being programmed to do so. Artificial intelligence is a very broad statement that just means giving machines person-like qualities. So when we make a robot that can walk very fluidly, not really learning, that's part of artificial intelligence. Because we've given the robot some intelligent property, i.e. walking fluidly. So I think artificial intelligence is a very broad category. Machine learning is a very specific part of artificial intelligence where we teach computers to learn without being explicitly programmed. Now, my definition of machine learning is a class of algorithms which are data-driven. Unlike classical algorithms, it is the data that defines a good answer. Now, here's an example to kind of clarify that definition. A non-machine learning algorithm would try to define a face. And I would tell the machine, when you see a photo, look for a kind of roundness structure, look for two white things, call them eyes, look for something red around here, we'll call those lips, look for kind of something protruding off the side, call them ears, If you see all those things, it's probably a face. That's a non-machine learning algorithm. That's me telling the computer what a face is, and then it doing it a million times in a second. Fine. Now, a machine learning algorithm, if that machine learning algorithm wanted to find a face, what I would do is, I would give it 1,000 examples of a face, and 1,000 non-examples of a face. So here's 1,000 faces, and here's 1,000 unicorns. And I tell them, these are faces, these are unicorns. Now it's going to go through all 2,000 of them, and it, the machine learning algorithm, is going to figure out, okay, I'm pretty sure I see the difference after many examples between a face and a unicorn. Now give me the 2,000 first photo, and I will tell you if it's a face or not. That's a machine learning algorithm. I never told it what a face was. I just gave it examples of faces. It goes, this is a face, and this is a face. This is not a face. This is a face. And it figured out along the way. In photos, I would give it a training set with more than 3 images. And I would say, this is a face, this is not a face, and this is a face. And I would keep going. It would then figure out, okay, I'm pretty sure I now see the difference between a headshot and not a headshot. And then the 2001st, the next photo, I ask it the question, face? And it will look back at its training and say, okay, this kind of looks like some of the other headshots. I'm going to go ahead and call it a headshot. Yes, it's face. That's in essence what machine learning does. Now, the core of machine learning deals with either representation or generalization. And to be put in more specific words, supervised versus unsupervised learning. Now, who's heard the term predictive analytics? Yes, most people have either probably read that term in some New York Times article and said, smart people at MIT use predictive analytics and they're still smart. Predictive analytics can be stated another way. It's called supervised learning. Supervised learning is synonymous with predictive analytics. It's all about making predictions about something. And we're going to break that down even further. But supervised learning means making predictions. That's what it means. When someone says, I have a supervised machine learning model, they're trying to predict something. And that's generalization. So if I tell it, I want you to predict if this photo is a face or not, it is trying to generalize the notion of being a face so that when it sees a specific one, it can hone in on it and say, yes, that is a face. That's called generalization, supervised. Unsupervised is not about making predictions. Unsupervised learning is about extracting structure from where there seemingly isn't. So you might have heard something called a cluster analysis. A cluster analysis would be a type of unsupervised learning. There isn't really a question per se. I'm not saying, tell me which ones are faces. There's no really directive. I just have a lot of unstructured data, and I want to see if there's anything underlying there. Like, is there some kind of mathematical structure that I'm not seeing? Is there some kind of... A big example of unsupervised learning can be finances. You know, you have a whole slew of financial data with seemingly no structure, and given an unsupervised model, what it would try to do is try to figure out if there's some sort of underlying mathematical structure there that the human can't necessarily see right away. And that's an example of representation. We're trying to represent data in a new way that we can't see. It's not obvious to humans right away. So supervised and unsupervised. Supervised is predictions, unsupervised is not. It's about extracting structure. And there's two types of data that we usually deal with. And it's not like they're drastically different. The main difference between the two types of data, supervised, we use something called labeled data. Labeled data means I actually give it examples with the label next to it. This is a face. This is a face. This is a unicorn. This is a face. This is a face. This is a unicorn. I'm telling it the label. That's called labeled data. If there is a label, if I have worked out examples of the thing I'm trying to predict, it's called labeled data. The exact opposite is true if it's unlabeled. If there is nothing that I'm trying to predict, if there's no label to any of the rows or pieces of data, it's called unlabeled. And And the difference between labeled and unlabeled is truly in the eye of the beholder.
And what I mean by that is, I could say, okay, let us, if I have, for example, if I want to try to predict, I'll use stocks again. If I want to predict the stock price, and I'm maybe given, you know, sentiment about how people feel about the stock and yesterday's price, I might use A and B to try to predict why. That would be a label. I'm telling you, okay, here was a sentiment, here was yesterday's price, and here's today's price. I'm looking at it, it's right here. Okay, here was 2 days ago sentiment, here was 2 days ago yesterday's price, and here's yesterday's stock price. So I can give it a whole list of days and say, okay, here's the label. I could also have just said, okay, here's three columns. Go. I'm not trying to predict any of them. I want to see how they're related. Is there a relationship between sentiment and stock value? Is there a relationship between sentiment and yesterday's price? Can I find correlations between any of these columns? Now, usually, unsupervised learning, this idea of just, I don't have a question. I just want to extract as much structure as possible. That's usually a great first step into predictive analytics. It's, can I extract more structure from this data before I start trying to predict things that will affect the outcome of my life? Now, the last example, the faces one, with the faces and the horses, that was a supervised machine learning model. Supervised because it was making predictions, and the label was me saying face, not face, face on the left-hand side. So this is an example of supervised machine learning. So let's kind of dive a little deeper into supervised learning. Now, in supervised learning, and here's some terminology that I'm going to be using for the next 50-odd hours over the next weeks. Math's hard. Well, you have a list of predictors.
Predictors are the things that we're going to use to predict the cool thing. So another word for predictors would be features. Independent variables for you math people out there, inputs, regressors, covariates, attributes. And we also have a response, and we usually call that Y. The response can be also called an outcome, a label, a target, or a dependent variable. So
if you recall, I apologize for using math examples. No, I don't. Math is important. Does anyone remember a function notation? Right, f is a function. I know PTSD kicks in right about now. But in function notation, what do you usually write? F of x equals y. Ever wonder why we do that? Well, f of x equals y is a sentence that says y depends on x. How? Maybe it's quadratic, maybe it's cubic, maybe it's logarithmic, maybe it's exponential, but somehow y depends on x. And the way we get from x to y is through this function f. So in machine learning, this chair is just not doing it for me. Excellent. In machine learning, this x is what we call a predictor. The y is called a response. And f, you can think of f as our machine learning model. The f is what we are trying to figure out. We're trying to ascertain what f is. How do we get from inputs to response? That's machine learning. Sure, if we knew that y equals x squared, well, we'd be done. There's nothing to do. The point of machine learning is we don't know f, we're trying to figure it out. Now, you might have heard of something called linear regression. It's like a dog, orf, I know that one. What is linear regression? What's another term for linear regression?
What's linear regression?
A trend line, that's fair. In terms of f, x, and y, what does it mean? Yes, the f can be approximated using a line.
If we can approximate our machine learning model as a line, that's called linear regression. And we've all probably done at some point in our lives, a best fit line or a trend line, or maybe even called it a linear regression in a marketing or an economics or a math class, stats class. You might even call it linear regression, what it is. Now, I'm here to tell you, linear regression is but one of an infinite many types of regression. Regression itself means something. Regression, it's actually very simple. Regression means that I'm trying to predict a continuous number.
That's it.
Someone want to remind me what continuous means? What does it mean for a number to be continuous, or a variable to be continuous?
There's always new data points.
Not necessarily there's always new data points. Unlimited, or we're getting there, yes, unlimited. Another way to say it is that this exists on a range. There's a range of values.
They're infinitely divisible.
Sorry?
They're infinitely divisible.
Yes, there's an infinite many of them, but we have to remember that they exist on a range. There's a range of infinite values. For example, price is generally thought of as a continuous variable, even though, theoretically, you can have a very small increment of money and stop there. Theoretically, money is continuous. Have you ever noticed at a gas station, what's the price of gas?
$3.99 and 9 cents.
Whoa, you can't just add another decimal there? Of course they can. In fact, if you look at stock prices, they usually go to 7 or 8 decimal points. Money, yes. Money goes to 7 or 8 decimal points. So we usually regard price as a continuous variable because there's near infinity of them. Blood pressure. Can be thought of as a continuous variable. Sure, we have the extreme limits of the human body, but theoretically, that can exist on a scale. What are some other examples of continuous numbers that we want to predict? What else exists on a scale? What do you think? Desiree.
Temperature.
Temperature. Again, you can argue that temperature does exist on a minimal and a maximal scale, but theoretically, there is an infinite range of values in between. That's what makes it continuous. One more continuous range. Wait, time. That thing, there it goes. Time is continuous. Well, some physicists would argue with me. In fact, in my last class, physicists did argue with me. But I'm gonna go ahead, if that's okay, I'm gonna go ahead and regard time as continuous. Yes, permission? Granted, great, thank you so much. What? Well, fair enough. I think you are. Anyways, that's regression. Regression means trying to predict a continuous value. Maybe we're trying to predict price of stock. Maybe we're trying to predict the time. Maybe we're trying to predict blood pressure. If we're trying to predict something continuous, it's called regression. If you want to do it using a line, it's called linear regression, a specific type of regression. But in general, it's just called regression. And we will see many regression models in this class, not just linear. If y, our response, is categorical, not continuous, there's in categories, distinct categories, it's called, supervised learning is called classification. So the base example of classification is animals. There are only a finite amount of types of animals in the world. Fine, argue genetics is slightly different than the other. But the way we regard animals, there's only a finite number of types of animals and we classify them in a taxonomy. Other things we can classify, spam and ham, in terms of emails. And emails, either spam, it goes into the spam folder, or it doesn't. It's ham and it's good. There's no in between. You don't get half of the email that's kind of spam and the other half goes into, that doesn't happen. You either get the whole email or you don't. Classification, yes or no? Any true or false question? It's called classification. If you have to come up with an answer true or false, it is classification. Digits, 0 through 9. If I write down a digit and I ask you what digit is that, you only have 10 options, 0 through 9. That's classification. Even though it's image-based, it's still classification, not regression. It's not as half a 0 and part of a 1. That's not what I asked. What digit did I write down? Cancer class. Cancer is divided into 4 grades.
1
1, 2, 3, 4. Stage blank cancer. There are only 4 stages. You cannot have stage 3.7 cancer. You either have 3 or 4. That's classification. In fact, one of the companies I consult for, they are creating machine learning algorithms that take in photos of cancer cells and output 104 numbers, 1, 2, 3, or 4, on a cancer grade. And when I work with them, we're making a classification algorithm. Because there is no range.
Can anyone think of another categorical thing that we like to talk about, that we want to predict? What else exists in categories in the world?
Jeopardy.
Jeopardy? Kind of. I mean, that's a tough one, because I guess theoretically there are infinite many answers, because there are infinitely many things that can occur in nature.
Elections.
Elections. That's a good one. Elections. Who's going to win an upcoming election? You only got so many choices. The lesser of blank evils. Sorry.
I've never heard. I'm not political.
Are you
going to
get
card game? I didn't hear that.
Sorry. Card game? Dice game? Yeah, most gambling games have a finite number of outcomes. And classification might help you out in a jam. Probably not. Don't do it.
One more. One more classification.
Credit rating.
Actually, that's interesting. Credit rating, I will argue that credit rating could be considered either categorical or regression. You could consider, theoretically, that my credit score exists on a scale of, what is it, 0 to 800 or something like that.
Let me rephrase.
Okay.
Corporate credit rating.
Corporate credit rating?
From A to
C. Oh, yeah. Okay, so when you apply for a loan and they categorize your credit, yes. So when you apply for a loan, your credit score gets reduced down to, I believe, it's A through F or G or something like that. There's only a finite number of them, and there's like 6 categories that you're allowed to be in.
In fact, one of them in the past class was a prediction of exactly that. They were trying to predict what grade their credit was based on other factors.
Yes, so the interesting thing about regression and classification is that you can think of the same question in a slightly different way and come up with a regression versus classification problem. Okay, I'm going to ask 2 questions.
What's the temperature of that?
Yes.
I just asked potentially the same question in 2 different ways, and what are the 2 answers I got? 85 and sunny. One of those is a regression problem, the other is a classification problem.
We have to be very careful about the way we ask a question, because all I wanted to know was, should I wear a sweater outside? But if I ask, what's the temperature and what's the weather like, I'll get 2 different answers, and now everything's a little bit more confusing. So this is an example of, we have to be very careful how we phrase the question. Because if you're talking about credit score that you might see on a FICO credit score or a credit grade in a loan application, one can be very well regarded as a regression, the other one's definitely classification. So you have to be very careful about how we ask questions as opposed to what machine learning model we're going to use. KNN is 98% of the time used for a classification. So if your question involves a regression, KNN likely won't be of much help. Does that make sense? The difference between classification and regression. So far, we have machine learning. Machine learning exists in either supervised or unsupervised. Supervised means what?
Predictions,
predictive analytics. Making predictions, supervised learning.
The 2 types that we've learned are regression, and we have classification.
Now, data are composed of observations, predictors, and their associated response. And data can also be called sample, examples, instances, and records. So here's an example, and this might be familiar to you. It's the example we looked at in the intro to data science class. This is predicting neonatal infection. So what type of problem is this? Is it supervised or unsupervised? Supervised. Why? We're making a prediction. The question was, can we detect what is the response Did the child develop an infection, true or false? Is that regression or classification? Classification. There's only two options, yes or no. Did they develop the infection? The data, those 16 vital signs collected by the incompetent student in college, those are all predictors. Those are the things that we're going to use to predict the response, which is the question, will the child develop an infection, yes or no? So here's an example of a supervised classification problem with predictors and sample response. Here's the Irish data set, made a little bit prettier. Here's the Irish data set. There are 150 observations, flowers. There are four predictors, P usually equals four. And what we're going to be doing today is trying to predict the species, which is our response. We're going to try to predict the response based on the four predictors. So we're going to try to create a function or a machine learning model that, taking in four predictors, will spit back a prediction of a response. So KNN is supervised. Supervised uses what we call training cases. Like I told you, this is a horse, this is a face, this is a face, this is a horse. That's called your training set, for obvious reasons. We train the machine learning model based on that data for the purpose of accurately predicting unseen test cases, understanding which predictors affect the response and how. For example, if I give you 20 different ways or 20 different facts and I ask you to predict the stock price, and you find out that only 5 of those 20 are actually useful, that's good to know. So now I can understand which of the predictors are actually affecting the response and how. If I tell you the sentiment of the stock, the yesterday's price of the stock, and whether or not it was sunny in Hong Kong yesterday, and I ask you to predict the price of the stock today, the weather in Hong Kong yesterday probably is not as important as the sentiment of the stock around the world. So with this supervised learning, part of it is dealing with how do we know which of the predictors are actually affecting the response and how. Or it's maybe even just opposite of positive versus negative correlation. As sentiment goes up, price goes up. As sentiment goes down, price goes down. That's what we want to know. And we always want to assess the quality of our predictions. How well are we doing? Like if someone says it's 85 degrees outside, how good of an estimate is that? That's the idea. So if you want to establish a relationship between someone's salary and a couple of demographic variables, we might do so in the following three graphs. So if I want to predict someone's wage based on how old they are, I'll get a cluster of data points, and then I'll try to draw some kind of curve. Look at what a great curve this is, too, that goes right through the data. Here, I'm trying to predict wage as opposed to the year that they graduated from their most recent education level. Here, I want to predict their wage based on their education level, where 5 is PhD, master's, bachelor's, high school, or none of the above. So all three of these examples are trying to show a relationship between wage and another variable. Now, what do you notice about these three variables on the bottom? Are they continuous? Some, not all. Age can be considered as a continuous variable, but I'll tell you that in census data, age is actually categorical because age is your legal age. You know, I am 20 for 364 days, and then the next day, I am 21. That is a category. There is not, in legal age, there does not exist, oh, he's 20, oh, he's almost 21. See, they never did that, right? Because it's a category. You're either 20, you're 21, you're 22, and so on. So in census data, we're generally regarding age as a classification. It's not a scale, per se. And yes, there are arguments where you can say, well, what if I just make it a continuous variable and round. That's not bad, that's fine. But that's also not the point of the slide. Year is also considered a category because I'm not asking the exact millisecond you graduated from college, I'm asking in what year did you graduate? You either graduated in 2009 or 2010. Education level is much more, obviously we can agree that education level is definitely a category.
Even if you choose to regard age and year as a continuous variable, the point is not the x-axis, it's the y-axis. What makes all three of these a regression and non-debatable regression example is because the thing that we're trying to predict, the y, the dependent variable, is wage. Wage is money. That money is continuous. It doesn't matter what we're trying to use to show a relationship to wage. The fact that I'm trying to show a relationship to wage on the y-axis, being a continuous variable, that's what makes it regression. Even if you want to say this is categorical, it doesn't matter. What makes it regression is the fact that the y-axis is continuous. That's why all three of these examples are regression. Because the thing we're trying to predict, the thing we're trying to show the relationship to, is continuous. I know I'm repeating myself a lot, but this is really important. So 2 weeks from now, when I say, today is another example of classification, we don't have to go back and say, what's classification? What is classification? Here's an example. Here, I'm trying to predict whether or not someone will have a heart attack on the basis of demographic variables. Diet, whether or not they smoke, obesity level, blood pressure. And here you can see what you would have obtained in some kind of scatter matrix between several demographic variables. Now, the thing we're trying to predict is what? Someone tell me the response.
Heart attack.
Heart attack? Yeah, true or false? Heart attack? Question mark. Argue me all you want. Medically speaking, you either had a heart attack or you didn't. And people who have had heart attacks will also say the same. You either had a heart attack or you didn't have a heart attack. So this is a very cut and dry case. We want to know when someone is at risk of having a heart attack. Yes or no. So no matter what we use to try to predict it, blood pressure, age, how many cigarettes they smoke in a year, however you want to regard them as continuous or categorical, the fact that the thing we're trying to predict is true or false, will this person have a heart attack, is what makes it classification. The response is what makes it regression or classification. Again, this is a very famous data set called the MINST data set. It's actually freely available. I put the source at the bottom on Stanford. It is a literal zip file of photos of the digits 0 through 9. And it's a very famous problem to see who can make the best digit recognizer out of these photos. In fact, it's a Kaggle competition, which I'll mention again later today. It's that machine learning community online. Kaggle also has another one that actually expired in May. Oh, shoot. Well, anyways, they had a contest to see if you could predict the type of forest based on satellite data. Of a satellite orbiting over the forest, can you predict what type of forest it is? Not just is it a redwood, is it a blank kind of forest, but it's health as well. So here they have the different categories, spruce, lodgepole, ponderosa, aspen, Douglas fir, crumb holes. And the data set, they had 15,000 observations of forests, with including making label data, making it supervised, making classification. This terminology will come very secondhand to you. And in total, they had to predict 565,000 forests and see how well they could do it. That was the competition. Fleshly, it was a good one. So that's supervised learning. Supervised learning is about making predictions, and those predictions are either of continuous or categorical. If it's continuous, it's called regression. If it's categorical, it's called classification. Question?
Yeah, was there a third category just behind classification, just under classification? The first
slide? There was not, I believe. There should have been supervised, unsupervised, and then...
Yeah,
sure. So you mean the very beginning, right?
Yeah.
Here? This representation was just a pointing to extract instructors.
No, not that one. The one where you define the function and talk about why it's continuous regression.
Oh, no. This is me talking about data
okay.
Being composed of observations. The two types of supervised are regression and classification. Those are the two types. So unsupervised learning is a little bit more fuzzy. It's fuzzy because there is no prediction. There is no question, per se. There is no response variable in terminology sake.
There's no response. There's nothing that I want to predict.
There is just a set of predictors X. There is no Y. The point is actually a little bit more open than supervised. And supervised is very cut and dry.
Did I, will you have a hard time? Yes or no? That's a very simple question. Well, simple question. It's a very simple answer, yes or no.
Here, we're trying to find groups of observations that behave similarly. Or we're trying to find predictors that behave similarly. Or a combination of features that explain the variation in data. So big examples are customer or purchasing data. Purchasing data. If I give you a million people's purchasing habits on iTunes, you want to find, okay, these people behave similarly because they're iTunes fanboys. They buy everything on iTunes when it comes out. These people are, you know, pirates. You know, they'll get all the free stuff and that's it. So you try to cluster these types of people that are similar to each other but different from everyone else. We'll see an example of that. The problem with unsupervised learning is it's very difficult to evaluate how well you're doing. Because there's no question. When there's no question, there's no answer. When there's no answer, I can't tell if you're wrong. What's in this cup? What? Someone say pee? No, but there. No, you're wrong. Because the question had an answer, your answer is incorrect. It's very easy to tell how well you're doing. What's in this cup? Coffee, yes. The question had an answer, the answer was coffee, you are right. Now, when you have an unsupervised model, that's something like, okay, let's take this, and this, and this. All right, what's similar and what's different? That is a very open question. They're all containers, but one is safe to drink, the other is not very safe to drink. So this is kind of a question, and this kind of question and answer becomes very ambiguous. All you want to know is, okay, I have this data. What is similar? What is different? That's why it's called unlabeled. There is no label. There's no answer. There's no way to tell how well you're doing easily. Now, there are metrics to tell how well you are doing if you have a vaguely specific goal. If your goal is to cluster the data into different little clusters of people or clusters of whatever it is you're trying to look at, then there are coefficients for handling that, which we will look at. Now, the great thing about unsupervised learning is that it is a way of extracting structure, or the representation, of data of which you have very little idea of what's going on. So usually, it's a very useful pre-processing step for supervised learning. If you have a question, sometimes it's very good to just say, you know what, let's forget the question and just try to figure out as much as we can about the data set before we start asking a question. Because the problem with asking a question right out of the cage is what? It's called a self-fulfilling prophecy. Is that when you have an idea about the answer, your data tends to skew towards that answer, doesn't it? And it's because you have this preconceived notion of what the data is supposed to do, and your results always tend to go towards it. However, if you stop and forget the question and just treat it as if it were just another variable, you can actually get a lot more structure than you would have ignored earlier on. Now, some of the common techniques are called clustering or principal components analysis. And again, we do both of those in this class. For principal components analysis, we'll be making our own file compression engine, trying to extract structure of files and using that structure to condense it down into something smaller. So, the summary is that there are two types of machine learning, supervised and unsupervised. Supervised is making predictions, unsupervised is not, it's an extracting structure. Now, for each of these, there are two types two different breaks. We have continuous supervised models, which is called regression. We have categorical supervised models called classification. Continuous unsupervised, we generally turn to dimension reduction. And categorical unsupervised is generally called clustering. Why generally? Again, without a very specific question, it's hard to give you a very specific name of what we're doing. In this class, we will see at least one of all of these. We'll probably see more supervised, more predictive models than unsupervised, but we will be looking at unsupervised models as well in this class. So,
As a clustering example, here I have very basic, and I just want to visually show you what I mean by clustering. If I have two attributes, two predictors, X and Y, and it happens that these points are kind of showing together, these points are hanging out, these points are hanging out, these points are hanging out. The idea is, can we find groups of points that are behaving similarly to each other, but different from everyone else? So these purple points are up here, are very similar to each other. These red points are also similar to each other, but red and purple are not very similar to each other. And we'll take a look at that in the Iris dataset. When we remember we did that scatter plot of petal length versus petal width, the scatter plot also happened to look very clustered. So we'll use that to our advantage. Here's my favorite example. There's this website, it's still live, it's at the bottom, it's super fun. I'll do it in the break. Esri.com, what they did was they took census data, combined it with purchasing data, combined it with other demographic variables. And what they did was, they clustered to find 67 different types of people who behave similarly to each other, but different from everyone else. Why 67? Because 66 and 68 gave them bad metrics, 67 happened to give them good metrics. So they deduced there are 67 types of people. They took it one step further. They made a map of people and where they live. So when you click on an area code, or a zip code, it will show you the breakdown of the types of people who live there. You're looking at General Assembly in D.C. This is General Assembly in D.C. in 20005. 72% of them are what they call metro renters. 17% are called laptops and lattes. And 11% of them are called trendsetters. Well, 70% of them, why? Well, the cluster that they call metro center, here's how they behave similarly to each other. They're young, mobile, educated, or still in school. They live alone or a roommate. You can see how not all of them are very distinguishing. They work long hours. They buy groceries at Whole Foods and Trader Joe's. They go to Banana Republic, Nordstrom, Gap. And they love yoga, skiing, and Pilates. So what's another word for metro runner? Hipster. Yeah, it's a bunch of hipsters living in D.C. General Assembly. And it's quite annoying. I'll do this area code here during the break, so I am curious. But this is an example of clustering. They took, and again, why it's clustering is because they took all the census data. And there wasn't a question. There wasn't I wonder if this person will go to North School, or I wonder if this person will attend yoga this week. There was no question. They just wanted to see if there were groups of people who behaved similarly to each other, but different from everyone else. That's called clustering. That's unsupervised learning, because there was no question. It's not, are they going to have a heart attack? Or are they going to die on the Titanic? Which is probably no, unless they make a second one. But that's unsupervised. Yes?
When there's no question, how could they arrive at something like, okay, this set of people works longer?
Good question. So they have to define long hours. Yeah, so this is a part of unsupervised learning is there's more human intervention in unsupervised learning, which is kind of, it's actually kind of a misnomer in that sense where the unsupervised or supervised. You have to hold the unsupervised model's hand a little bit more than you have to hold the supervised model's hand. Because an unsupervised model, long, doesn't mean anything to the computer. We have to define what long is. Now, that's not to say that we can't do that in a supervised model, because if I just have a column that says hours worked per day, in either in supervised or unsupervised, I still might want to say, okay, fine, take this column, anything 10 plus, call it long, anything 8 to 10, call it average, anything 5 to 8, call it short. So I can still turn our continuous into categorical in unsupervised or supervised. But the point stands, in an unsupervised model, there is more human intervention because it takes a human to say, stop, this is good, generally. It takes a human to say, okay, good, this is good enough unsupervised, let's roll with it. Which is why 67 is a weird number.
So also, before running the model itself, do we have to define the set of clusters or the buckets that we want, right?
Good question. The question was, do we have to identify the clusters beforehand? And the answer is yes and no. Some models, yes. Some models, no. In fact, more often than not, the answer is no. More often than not, we're not going to predefine the clusters. We're going to ask the computer, figure out some clusters. And then the human will come in. The Metro Renter, the computer did not come up with that name, or laptops and lattes. The computer came up with this part. The computer said, here are all the facts. Here are all the facts about what I think I'm going to call this. And then the human looks at it and goes, okay, let's call them Metro Renters, and that kind of makes sense. So there's kind of more human intervention there. But the human did not have that idea in mind before. The computer came up with that cluster. The human just gave it a name. So again, here's a summary of unsupervised, supervised, continuous, and categorical. Now, we have time before the break, luckily. I will begin with classification with k-nearest neighbors. I will do this before the break. We'll take a break. We'll come back, and we will dive right into creating our own k-nearest neighbors algorithm. So k-nearest neighbors involves making predictions. So here's a pop quiz. Making predictions about a finite number of things. What type of model is k-nearest neighbors? Supervised learning. Why do you say supervised learning? Because I said prediction, right? Why is it classification? Because I said finite number of things. So k-nearest neighbors will be using as a classification model on Iris today. Today we'll be trying to predict flower species, of which there are how many in our data set? Three. Setosa, Virginica, Versicolor. There are only three flower types. They're all irises. But Setosa, Virginica, Versicolor are the three types of irises that we were trying to predict. The predictors that we will be using are sepal length, sepal width, petal length, petal width. So again, this is the idea that the intern runs in and goes, I wrote down the sepal length, sepal width, petal width of this flower. Here you go, Fisher. Fisher's like, whoa, what's the flower? What is it? And the intern goes, I'll show myself the door. And he leaves. And then Fisher, or the machine learning specialist, will then throw those four numbers into the F function, the machine learning model, and the function will say, oh, it's a Setosa, or oh, it's you know, this, it's probably a Versicolor. I'm predicting Versicolor. So as a more visual, attributes go into this black box of science, as Bill and I would put it. Out of the black box of science comes out the class label. Why? So you can think of, here is our F in the middle, the classification model. That's our function. We're going to use a model to try to find a relationship between X and Y. Here's how KNN works. I apologize if anybody is mildly colorblind. I will not point you out, but I will tell you the colors of all the dots on the screen. This is blue. This is red, blue, green, green, I'm recording. Green, red, blue, gray. We want to predict the color of the gray dot. Because I want it to be red, blue, or green. So my first questions to you are the following. What are the predictors? What are the response? Let's do the easy one first. What is the response of the question that's asked? What's the response? Someone repeat it back to me. Okay, now what's the response? Color. What is the color? Red, green, blue. Perfect. Thank you. What are the predictors?
X and Y.
I'm hearing a lot of things. Most generally, X and Y. The only thing we know about this dot is its X and Y location. What does X and Y represent? I don't know, number of bubblegum drops and number of, and whiskers on kings. Sad music, okay. All we know is X and Y. And we're gonna use those two predictors, X and Y, to predict the response, which is either red, blue, or green, making a classification. Here's how we do it. The one thing we have to define before we do the machine learning model is K. We have to preset K. For this example, I will call k3. And k is an integer. Of the gray dot, we find the colors of the k nearest neighbors. We find the colors of the k nearest neighbors. From the gray dot, the nearest neighbors are this blue one, and this red one. I then assign to the gray dot the color of the most seen color of those three nearest neighbors. Congratulations, you're all machine learning specialists. That's it. That is KNN, which is why it's the teacher of machine learning's best friend. It is such a simple model. We will pick a value for K, 3. We will take an unseen test case, find its three nearest neighbors, this blue one, and that red one. Of the two blues and one red, blue occurred most frequently, therefore that dot must be blue. That is KNN. Now, it sounds almost too simple. It sounds almost too simple, but isn't that how we learn things? I mean, if you think about it, if someone asks, what does Sanan do for a living? I go, oh, I don't know, tell me about it. Well, he codes, he knows math, he teaches at General Assembly, but I don't know what, he teaches at General Assembly. What do you think? Well, if he knows math and code, he probably, I mean, all my math and coding guys are like data guys. He probably knows like databases. That's exactly how we learn things. We see other people and their attributes, and we try to lump me into a category of other people who are similar, and we call it data guys. That's what we do. It's another word for stereotyping. KNN is advanced stereotyping. I've never thought of it that way. Wow. Oof. Does it make sense? Now, obviously in this example, X and Y are meaningless, nameless, and the color is also meaningless. But the point still stands. We will try to turn that dot, find the three closest neighbors, and then of the thing that occurs the most in those three, that's the answer. Now, no one has yet asked me, what does close mean? Well, in this particular example, things, dots are close to each other if they're physically Euclidean distance formula, BTSD, distance formula close to each other on the XY axis. Why? Because that's the easiest way to find distance between two points in n dimensions. Because the distance formula, that x minus x1 squared plus y minus y1 squared and the square root of all that, yes, the distance formula can be extended into infinite dimensions. So no matter how many data attributes we have, we can always use Euclidean distance. Now, are there any questions about the actual model? When we come back from the break, I will go over it very quickly again before we implement our own. But are there any questions of generally how this works? Okay, fair enough. Some advantages. It's very simple to understand and explain. Given an unseen point, find three of them that are the most similar, and of those three, whichever is the mode, whichever occurs the most frequently, call it that. That's the answer. Model training is very fast because there isn't much to do in the training department. It's just distance formula. You're just calculating a lot of distance formulas. And it's non-parametric, which is a fancy word for we don't have to assume the shape of the data. Like, for example, if those dots were arranged in a circle, it doesn't matter. Because I could put a point right here, and the distance formula would still tell me, okay, these are the closest points to it. Not this one, not that one. So the distance formula still works even if we don't have to assume the shape of the data. Disadvantages. Prediction can be very slow when n, the number of training observations, is very large. Why? Why does training make sense? Dwayne, I'll put the picture back up. Now, be a human and think slow, because this is how we dissect machine learning models. Be a human, but try to think slow and to really understand what you're doing. Now, I'm going to ask this question again. What are the closest dots to this one? Here and here and here. How did you do that so fast? I'm serious. This is sounds stupid, but bear with me. How did you just do that? And this is where it separates a data scientist from a data analyst. Okay. So this is very difficult to do. How did you figure out that these three are the closest dots? Fair enough. You eyeballed the distances. But why didn't you say this one?
Because you assume that there's three different centroid points.
Too complicated. Sorry, too complicated. Your brain did not do that fast. I promise you. No offense. Neither did mine. No one's brain did that fast. If you did, come see me after class. Why isn't this the closest point? Because there are closer ones. That's literally, yeah, there are closer ones. How do you know there are closer ones? Because in your head, you eyeballed both distances and picked the smaller one. So what am I getting at? As a human, what did you do really fast? You found the distance between this dot and all of the other dots, and then very quickly figured out that these three were the smallest ones. That's what you did in your head very quickly. That's what KNN also has to do on a computer. Every time a new dot comes in, it has to look at all of the distances between all of the other points and then pick the three smallest ones. That's how the computer has to do it. There are ways of making that faster. For example, what you could also do, oh wait, I can do this. What you could have done, and argue that you could have done, was start here and start doing the following, like a radar. Keep going until you hit 3 points. And once you've hit 3 points, you're done. Yes?
Typically, how is K determined?
I'm sorry, can
you
say that again?
How is K determined?
Oh, how is K determined?
We'll pick 5 or 7.
We will pick 5 and 7 and 1 and 2 and 9, and we will see which one works best. That's part of the metric evaluation. We can automate that process, but there is no better process than trying several of them and seeing which one works best. How do you think they came up with 67 clusters? I'll tell you, they tried 0 through 100, and 67 had the best metrics possible. That's how they did it. And yes, the computer will quickly tell us which is the best choice. But generally speaking, if you want to choose the optimal value for K, you will have to try many of them and compare the different metrics between them. The reason we have to do that is because there isn't one metric that says, if this number is bigger, this model is better in period. No. There's generally 5 different metrics that we're looking at, and they all bounce all over the place. So it's up to the human to say, okay, this K equals 3 has the best mix of metrics. Not all of them are the highest, but I care more about this one, if that's the highest, and this one doesn't matter so much, and it's kind of low, so it's fine. So we humans, unfortunately, still have to be the ones to say, okay, this is a good mix of metrics. I will choose K equals 3 for future purposes. Nick, does that satisfy? That's how we have to do it. And later on in scikit-learn, which is the model that does all this for us, it will give us visualization. It will actually plot the metrics for different values and circle the one. It will literally circle the one that says this is the best. And then we'll look at it and say, yes, I agree. So it gets really slow when it has to find the distance between all of the points. If I have a million Satosas or a million flowers and I have just one, it has to find the distance formula a million times and then pick the three smallest ones. It has to. So if you have too many training points, prediction is very slow. And it's very sensitive to irrelevant features. What that means is, if I want to predict whether or not you're going to buy a car, I will say the two factors are, oh, sorry, if I want to predict the price of the car based on the year of the car, like 2015 or in 2011, the year of the car are the model, let's go ahead and call it, and model quality. So we'll put that on a continuous scale where, you know, 10 is Lamborghini and 0 is
Peugeot.
Oh crap! What's the car that's got I've never even heard of that. The car that's got it's close to factory. Crap.
Tesla.
Okay. You get the point. 0 is a bad car. 10 is a really good car. And so here, and then we have this other axis for price, the thing you want to predict. there should be a fairly visual correlation between how new the car is, how good the quality of the model is, and how much it costs. That's just how cars work. Sorry. Now, here's the problem. In Euclidean distance, it matters the scale of everything. Now, what if I added another feature?
The fourth dimension is here.
And another feature that I'm going to try to use to predict the price
is going to be number doors.
Even two car doors can be really crappy. The problem is, this is a variable that has pretty much no correlation to the price because there are very expensive four-car doors and very cheap four-car doors. It has no relation to price, but it's going to skew everything. Because data that once existed in two dimensions, here, now maybe some of these points get shot off over here where there's four doors, and here there's two doors. So now because of Euclidean distance, we're changing the distance of the points without purpose. So when we add in an irrelevant feature, the points get thrown around in three, four, five-dimensional space, and the distances become more meaningless. Because I'm just throwing data points around by irrelevant features. It has four doors. It has this many watts in the stereo. And it has this many sunroofs. And then this many moonroofs. So you're just throwing the point around irrelevantly, and the distance is changing for no reason. So KNN is very, very sensitive to irrelevant features. Okay, that's the slide. So it is actually 8:05. Damn, so close. Let's take a 15-minute break, come back at 8:20. At 8:20, we're going to begin working on the lab.